I hope you're ready to worship the Lord with us today. I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in here. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Through the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in here. Testimony from death to life, 'cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not dead. Greater things are still to come. Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. From death to life. Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This morning. Never to forsake.
you began, you will sustain. This we know. This we know.
Raise it up this morning. The name of Jesus. Scream the name of Jesus this morning. He's in the building. Anybody glad to be here today? Let's lift a high praise this morning. Can we do that?
Yeah.
you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you.
Never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't. Something he is not. You and me, we can change. We can do whatever we want, make people think whatever we want them to think. We can just morph and change and become something different every day. We can be two different people, three different people, whatever suits us, whatever suits our flesh. But let me tell you about the King of Kings. We cannot abdicate his throne. He's God. He's always God. He never changes. He's royal. He's high and lifted up. And he's more powerful than anything in all the universe. Because he spoke it all into existence. And whatever someone has said about you, it doesn't feel good, and it doesn't feel like it's true, you got to stop listening to that voice. And it may be your own voice. You got to start listening to the voice of your Heavenly Father and believe what he says about you. Because you're blessed and cannot be cursed. You're the head, not the tail. That's what the Word of God says. Nobody can take God's plan from your life. You're in the palm of his hand. He knows what you're going to eat at your next meal. He knows the report that you're waiting on from the doctor. The thing that you're worried about. He's not worried about it. Because he's in control. And when we start speaking words that God says about us, stop listening to the lies that the enemy says about us, we're going to have victory in our lives. We're going to see something shift in the heavenlies. And I don't know about you, but I'm tired of bad news. I'm tired of hearing that stuff. And I'm tired of being told lies. You have the truth. Jesus said, I am the way and I am truth. And if he lives inside of you, you got truth inside of you to tell you what the difference is between a lie and the truth. His word is a two-edged sword. And it has the power to separate truth from a lie. If you don't know his word, you're not going to be able to tell when there is a lie coming at you. And you can't trust your emotions right now. How many of you have just felt like you've been on an emotional roller coaster with what's going on with the world? You read something one day, you hear something on the news one day, and your mood goes like this. And then the next day it's bad news, and you're back down. We got to stop letting the world be the barometer for our emotions. Only God controls that. And I don't care what's coming at you, if it's a tsunami, your God is bigger than that. And we got to start resting and depending on him. We've been declared in this song that he's a way maker. He's a promise keeper. He cannot lie. He's a truth teller. I don't know. I need to say that to myself today. I need to hear the word of the Lord for me today. So I just want to encourage you today. Don't be discouraged by what you see. You got to stand on who we know he is. He's big.
Stop working. You never stop. No, no. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, no.
Made the way. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus tells us over and over again in his word who he is, what his function is, what his relationship is to us. He says, I am the way. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the good shepherd, and I'm also the gate for the sheep. See, he is the way in. Oh, we thank you, Jesus, for your presence. We thank you for making a way when there was no way. Somebody just thank him for the blood this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Sometimes I just need to tell God who he is to me. Let's just take 60 seconds and just tell God who he is to you today. See, he's my provider. He's my father. He's my protector and my defender. He's my redeemer and my deliverer. He's my healer. He's my savior. He's my wonderful counselor. He's the comfort to all who mourn. He's the lifter of my head this morning. He's my reason for waking up this morning. Oh, we love you, Jesus. We thank you for all the things you are to us, God. We just glorify you today. We lift your name high. We give you glory. We say you're holy. We say you're worthy. We say you're wonderful, Jesus. Oh, what a wonderful Savior we have. What a wonderful Savior. Oh, we love you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You're bless your name. We glorify you today. We're so thankful for the opportunity to even come together this morning and glorify you. Give us ears to hear what your word is saying today, God. And plant it deep in our hearts. And may you find good soil in our hearts for your word to grow. We thank you for all the work that you're doing right now. Even when we can't see it, even when we don't feel it, we know you're working all the time. And we glorify you today. We bless your name. We bless your name. We ask these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Somebody say amen in this building. Amen. All right, go and have a seat.
Thank y'all so much for joining us here this morning. And for everybody that's watching online, we want to invite those who are watching online and even you who are here this morning to join us online again this Wednesday for our midweek hotspot services. And so we'll talk a little bit more about that here soon. But until then, we want to invite you to be part of our giving this morning, whether it's through FOTN.org, our text mobile giving, or the envelope in front of you. So however you're giving, let's go ahead and be obedient, faithful, trust God, and offer that up to Him this morning. So God, we thank you again so much, Lord, that in our finances and in every area of our life, God, where it seems like we've hit a roadblock, where it seems we've hit a wall, or where it seems there is no way, God, that you are our way maker. And we thank you, God, that it's not just some kind of fairy words that we sing, but that there is truth and there is depth in that, Father. And so this morning, we choose, if we haven't already, to not walk by what we can see, but we choose to stand on who we know that you are, Lord. You are our provider, Father, and you take what we give and you multiply it. And you use it for your glory. So this morning we ask that you would take this offering, you would do with it what you will, Lord, so that you receive the most honor, the most glory, and the most praise, God. And we thank you so much that as we walk in obedience, you don't have to, but you choose to work on our behalf, Lord. And so we want to show our gratitude, not just by what we say, but by what we do, Lord. We love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Choose to celebrate our graduates today, both who are here and those who might be watching online or aren't with us this morning. For those who don't know me, my name is Pastor Stephanie. I have the honor of being over our Student Nation ministry, and then my husband John and I, we also co-lead our young adult ministry together. And so we know that this has been As far as I know, one of the craziest seasons for seniors and graduates. And so we want to do something to at least honor them and give them recognition. And so unfortunately, we just have a few that are here this morning due to everything that's going on. But we want to give them honor, and we just want to celebrate them this morning. And so first, and as I call your name, you're welcome to come up here with your parents as well. So first, we have Eduardo Esparza. Eduardo is a college graduate from University of Houston with a major in accounting. He is also part of the honors organization, Beta Alpha Psi, and he is currently attending HCC to complete his CPA and has accepted a job offer from one of the major accounting firms. So we are so excited for Eduardo. And then next we have Ms. Kaylin Martinez. Kaylin is a high school graduate from North Shore High School. She was super involved in band and choir and did a lot of outstanding UIL competitions. Kaylin has also, within Fellowship of the Nations, has been to Panama. She's been a part of Inner Circle. She's been to all of our fall retreats, camps, you name it. She's been a part of it. And now that she's graduated, as of now, she is scheduled to leave on August 12th to join the U.S. Navy. So we are so, so proud. And this is just representing just a few of all that the Lord is doing in our senior and college graduates. And so I take this opportunity every year just to vocalize this while I can. But I just want to challenge you as parents, whether you're parents of babies, children, teenagers, or you still have young adults living at home, I just want to encourage you. I believe that there is no greater gift that you can give them than to train them in the ways of the Lord, to make church and community a priority and to get them involved. It is so, so, so important. And so if you're hearing this for the first time, whether you're watching this online or here, even though we're not meeting here on campus, we still have other virtual Bible studies in groups that they can get involved in. And so the best example you can do for that is to get involved yourself and to show that example to them. And so we just want to encourage you with that. And so with that being said, I just want to encourage you to stretch your hands out towards these, and we're going to pray for them this morning and bless them. So God, we thank you so much, Father, that these are your children, Lord. We just get to be a part of their life for just a tiny, tiny speck of a season, Lord. I thank you so much for Kaylin, Father, that you have literally allowed her to be nurtured in this church through your Holy Spirit, Father. We thank you so much, God, that what the enemy intended for good, you took it, Lord, and you made it greater and used it to groom her into the young lady that she is today, God. And I pray, Father, that as she approaches that shipment date, God, I thank you, Lord, that she's not just going on Navy territory, Lord, but she is going on a battlefield where she will be the woman of God holding up that double-edged sword that you've equipped her with, Father. And we thank you for that, God. We thank you for Eduardo and his family. We thank you, Father, that this is a mighty man of God that you are raising up, Lord. Whether his feet are on U of H ground or HTC or wherever he's at, God, I thank you, Lord, that you're using him as a reflection of your son, and you're protecting his heart and his character, Father. We pray for these parents and even the seniors who couldn't be here, Lord. We ask, God, that you would continue to equip parents, Father, to use your name and your word as a biblical foundation and raising up and nourishing their children in the ways of you, God. We thank you so much, Lord, and ask, God, that you would bless their days to come as they seek your face and your righteousness, Lord. And we thank you for what it is you're doing. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Can we give it up for them one more time this morning?
Thank you. And the people said, amen, amen. How's everybody doing? We good? All right, three of you said it's okay. Y'all good? Hey, listen, we want to welcome everyone, and not only here, but welcome everybody who is online watching. We greet you in the name of Jesus. Can we just give them a big old hand clap? All right. Glad we got a lot of people who are, they're at the house, and so, listen, we bless you in the name of Jesus. We are so thankful that you are tuning in today, and for these that are here, man, we just greet you in Jesus' name. So glad that you're here and walking in faith, and it's all good. Amen. And I wanted to announce this is our newest newlywed couple right here. And Juan and Yas, why don't y'all stand up? Stand up right there, Juan and Yasmin Fettis. Woo! They just got married yesterday. So I don't know. It's time to go on a honeymoon, man. I appreciate your faithfulness, but bro, you got to do something. Anyway, glad you're here. Anybody got the word? Word up, hold it in the air like you really, really care. Say it together. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. It is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. I will hide His Word in my heart so that I might not sin against God. Holy Spirit, give me ears to hear and strength to obey. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Amen, amen. Well, we are in the series, and really wanted to take some time to talk about salvation and what does it really mean to be saved. And so we talked about counting the cost, because I really believe that in today's time, and just let me share with even with you at home, today's time I believe that there is a form of religion, but I'm not sure that it's really the gospel where it's changing people's lives. I think it may be easy believism. I'm not sure, you know, as far as has there really been a transformation in some people's lives. So my responsibility as a pastor is to make sure that I take the Word of God and I give you the truth of what the Word of God says and just take it from what Jesus taught. That's basically all I'm doing. I'm just teaching you what Jesus taught. So we started out in Luke 14, and what Jesus was telling the crowds, he told them three things, and it was kind of a, sounded like it was negative, but he was really just want to get to the heart of the matter, and that was, he looked at him and said, you cannot be my disciple unless you love me more than your family or anybody else. And the reason why he was telling them that was because he knew that a lot of them, if they would follow Jesus, they would lose their family. They would not allow. They would be considered dead to them, and so they had to make a choice. Do you love me more than anybody else? So that was a bold statement, but Jesus was trying to get through their head. What are you really wanting to do? Are you really wanting to count the cost? And so the cost was, even if it means leaving my family, Jesus, I'm going to follow you. Then he said, you cannot be my disciple unless you take up your cross and follow me. Well, taking up our cross, it's a lot of times we have to nail the temptation and the sins of the flesh and our pleasure and anything that is displeasing to the Lord. We have to nail it to the cross if we're going to follow him. We may say, well, but I want to go this way. And Jesus says, no, follow me. He said, you can't be my disciple unless you follow me. Then he makes this statement and he says, you cannot be my disciple unless you're willing to give up everything you own. He said, if you're willing, didn't say you necessarily had to, but if you look at the disciples, that's exactly what they did. He called the four fishermen, Peter, James, Andrew, John. They were all fishermen. And what did he do? He says, drop your nets and come, I'm going to make you fishers of men. They give up everything they own. Matthew, the tax collector, working for the Roman government, what did he do? He said, come and follow me. He left everything he was doing and he followed Jesus. Well, Jesus makes that a statement. If you want to know what salvation is, this is how you got to love me more than anything, be willing to take up your cross and follow me, and be willing, even if necessary, to give up everything you own to follow me. So those are three things that we talked about the very first, and that's just Jesus teaching. Then he goes in John 3, the next week we talked about, you must be born again. In John 3, we see that Jesus was talking to Nicodemus. He was a religious leader. He came to him at night. And so what did he say? He said, hey, good master, how do you get to heaven? I know that you are sent from God. Nobody does the things you're doing except you're sent from God. But how do you get to heaven? And Jesus said, you must be born again. You must be born again. Have a spiritual birth. He said, you're born of water, you're born of the flesh, but now you have to have a spiritual birth, and you're born into the kingdom of God. So that's what he was telling there. Have you been born into the kingdom of God's family? That's a question we have to ask ourselves. Has there been a spiritual birth? Is that relationship of a father and a child there? It's not religion. It's relationship. And the people said, amen. So you need to have a relationship, a 24/7, go through the day talking with Jesus as you go. And then the last time we met, we talked about if this has really been in your life, if there's been a transformation that's taken place, then the fruit of that, he's talking about counting the cost, the fruit of that will cost you something. And what we talked about was time, talent, and treasure. So we only hit on time. And when you look at time, we just talked about this. We have to have time to worship. For an example, we are here today. We are worshiping together. The Bible says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves, right? So we are worshiping together. But really, our heart should be an attitude of worship all during the day. As we go through the day, we wake up in the morning. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Right? We go through the day. He said, I'll never leave you. I'm not going to forsake you. I mean, these are all the truths of the Word of God. So we have to take time to worship, not only individually unto the Lord, but together, corporately, we are here. Then it says, take time to walk in humility. Walk in humility. We're not going to be walking around arrogant. The fruit that we see, the character of our transformation is that we walk not those who are boastful and proud or whatever, but we walk in humility. Why? Because God resists the proud, but he exalts the humble. Amen? So we should take the time to walk that way. Then we take the time to pray. We look to the scripture, it says, pray without ceasing. We pray, it's an attitude of prayer. We just go through the day. We just have this attitude of just talking with God. That should be your daily practice. If you're driving down the road, are you talking to him? You wake up in the morning, right? You're sitting there having your cup of coffee. Who are you talking to? All right? Sometimes you're talking to yourself. Why don't you just talk to God instead? You don't have the answer. He does, all right? Just talk to the Lord. But pray without ceasing. Talk about it and everything. Then he says that there's time to stand against evil. Why? Because evil times are coming. And the Bible says in Ephesians 6, having done all, putting on the armor of God, but having done all, stand. Don't run. Stand. And what the enemy wants to do is he wants to remove faith and put fear in. He doesn't want you to stand. He wants you to run, right? Run in fear. Oh, my gosh, what's going to happen? What's the future going to be? No, stand in who you know he is and who he's already told you who you are and who I know that I am, a child of God. So there's a time to stand in the day of evil. And believe me, has there been any times of evil happening in our day? It's a mess. But God. Amen. And through the middle of this, in the midst of it, we're going to work. And then it says there's a time to forgive. 70 times 7, right? If somebody sins against you, it says if they come and ask for forgiveness, you just say, yes, sir, I forgive you. As God's forgiven us, we do that. And then there's a time to do good. It said always take the time to do good, because if you continue to run the race, he says you will reap a harvest of blessing. Don't give up. You keep doing the right thing. You do what God has created you for, what he wants to do in your life. You just keep doing it. So those are the things that we talked about. Now when we come, I want to, today to talk about the talents and time, talent, and treasure. But talent, we'll look at spiritual gifts. Spiritual gifts. Here's one thing that we know for sure, and you'll see this here in just a second. If you go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, that's the scripture we're giving you. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, we're talking about a spiritual gift. Every single one of you, if you're a born-again believer, you have one, at least one, all right? So let's look in. We're going to jump in because we see the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, all of that. The fruit of the Spirit is the character of Jesus Christ living through you. That's just the truth. That's how when people see us, they should see the character of Jesus. They should see love, joy, peace, patience, gentleness, goodness, kindness, faithfulness, self-control. All of that is the character of Jesus Christ. But when we come to the gifts of the Spirit, we see that that is for the ministry that God wants to do through each and every one of us. What we teach here is every member is a minister, and every minister has a ministry, right? All right, so this is what you need to see is you have a gift, and God wants you to be faithful to use that gift. All right, we're going to win. We're going to win the loss. So we need for every believer to be aware. So my job today is to help you understand that there is the Holy Spirit, number one, inside of you, but the Holy Spirit has given you a gift, and he wants you to use it for the blessing of the church and for the saving of lost souls. All right, we on the same page? All right, here we go. So we're going to jump in. 1 Corinthians 12, beginning with verse 3, it says, "So I want you to know that no one speaking by the Spirit of God will curse Jesus, and no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit." Then he gets here, and you got to understand what Paul was doing is he was writing to the church in Corinth. That particular church was really a very pagan church. They wanted the gifts of the Holy Spirit, but they abused them. They wanted to have, you know, they would have the Lord's Supper, but then they would bring their own food, and they would bring wine. They were getting drunk at the supper. I mean, it was just crazy what was going on. And they completely just kind of, they were just out of order. So he's writing chapters 12 and 14 to help put them in order. So he's telling us, says, there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit is the source of them all. Now remember, this is Christianity 101. When we get saved, the Holy Spirit, we've talked about this a lot, dwells within us, right? He is here. He, because he's there, he has a gift for you, wants to use it, and it's him doing this. So look what it says. There are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit is the source of power of them all. There are different kinds of service. Now let me talk about that just for a second. We have a lot of needs, we'll say, ministry needs here at the church. You may say, well, that's not my gifting. But what the Lord is saying is, no, but that is your area of service, right, to meet the needs of the house. Does that make sense? You may say, I don't have the gift of changing dirty diapers in Baby Nation, right? I promise you, I don't either. But there may be. There's a need, and so he's saying there are different kinds of service, but we serve the same Lord. What do? We meet the needs of the house. God works in different ways, but it's the same God who does the work in all of us, right? Paul, he gave the illustration. He said, it's like this. The body of Christ is like a body. It's like you may be a part. So he said, is everyone an eye? No. Does everyone play keyboard and sing? No. You know, is everybody up here preaching? No. We all have different types of gifts, right? And so he said, somebody may be an eye, there may be an ear, there may be a hand, there may be a foot, but they're all important. Would you agree? Right, every one of them, right? Your big toe is important, right? You think it don't mean nothing, it's just a big old stinker. No, it's not. It's for your balance. I mean, it's very important in your life. So every one of our gifts are important. You are a 10 in some area that God wants to use you in. All right, are y'all getting that? I want you to, here's, before I go any further, I gotta say this. One of the biggest tragedies in Christianity today is that people are living in fear and they feel like, oh, I can't do that. That's for somebody else. And what they do is they miss out on the reason why they were created. They really do. Living in fear, oh, that's got to be for something else. When you have a gift, God wants to use it to edify the church and to strengthen us. God wants to use it, but we're sitting there, oh, I don't know if I could do that or not. And it goes contrary to what the Word of God says. Are you ready? Here we go. I'm trying to help you. A spiritual gift is given to each of us so we can what? Let's say it together. It's given to who?
Us.
Each of us so we can what? Help each other. Is that how much? Let's read it one more time. A spiritual gift is given to each of us so we can help each other. You have a gift that's going to help me. I have a gift that's going to help you. The person sitting next to you has a gift that's going to help you. You got that? Every one of us are gifted by the Holy Spirit because there's an area of service. area of ministry that God has for you. Now, do y'all believe that? Okay. I want to make it very practical, because this is where I believe that people miss out. There's a lot of churches where they got, you know, maybe just a preacher and they got a handful of people, and that's all that's, you know, in front and ministry. That is not the church. So a spiritual gift is given to each of us so we can help each other. To one person, the Spirit gives the ability to give wise advice. Wise advice, right? I'm going to read these, and then we'll go over these and just explain them here in just a minute. So to another, the same Spirit gives a message of special knowledge. The same Spirit gives great faith to another. And to someone else, the one Spirit gives the gift of healing. He gives one person the power to perform miracles and another the ability to prophesy. He gives someone else the ability to discern whether a message is from the Spirit of God or from another spirit. Still another person is given the ability to speak in unknown languages. While another is given the ability to interpret what is being said. It is the one and only Spirit living in you who distributes all these gifts. He alone decides which gift each person should have. Does that make sense? All right. So the Holy Spirit living in each one of us, he's there. He's deciding, I have a gift for Caesar. That's his decision. I can't tell Caesar what his gift is. Holy Spirit's giving him his gift, right? You see what I mean? Every single one of us, we're in that same boat. We got to grab a hold of this truth. So let's talk about these just for a moment. Many gifts, one Spirit. So look at the gift of wisdom. That's wise advice, knowledge of the mysteries of the gospel, the ability maybe to explain them, wisdom. When you look at wisdom and knowledge and understanding, you see those. I'll explain. This is where we need the Holy Spirit. Now, James 1 says, if you lack wisdom, pray and he'll give it to you liberally, right? So wisdom is available. But the gift of wisdom is by the Holy Spirit that may help you to interpret. Maybe you're reading the scripture and all of a sudden you see it and you have an understanding. God has given you the Spirit of wisdom. You're sitting in a care group. You're leading a care group. And now God's given you some wisdom of helping them explain, rightly dividing the word, right? An exact understanding of the design, the nature, and the doctrine of the Christian faith. So that's wisdom or wise advice. Second one is knowledge. The knowledge of mysteries, right? Wrapped up in the prophecies, the histories of the Old Testament. Still others, you see a readiness to give advice and counsel, right? A word of knowledge could be given. You may have, you know, God may give you the ability, and he'll say, like, somebody will, will be at church, and the Holy Spirit may speak something in your life and says, I'm going to give you a word of knowledge for somebody else, right? That's a little scary, right? You know what I mean? But it's a word of knowledge. Now, can some of these be abused? Absolutely, right? But you trust in the Holy Spirit if it lines up with the Word of God, and God will give you, for some, a word of knowledge. So you get that concerning, it's a word of knowledge given by the Holy Spirit concerning a person or event. You'll see that. And you see it even later in Scripture. Paul had it, Peter had it, you see that. Then it talked about faith. It says you can have the gift of faith. And I believe at times that God will give you great faith to move his will concerning different things. Does that make sense? All right, I'll give you an example. When we were a young church, we talked about this before, but we had some property that we were going to buy. They wanted to sell to $600,000. I didn't have $600,000. We're just a handful of people. None of us had $600,000. But the Lord said, this is what I want you to do. We had to take a big step of faith. At that particular time, God gave faith. Does that make sense? He gave us faith to step out, and even though the bank said you got to write a personal guarantee, right, you got to take a step of faith. When we purchased these buildings, $2 million, I'm, you know, having to sign my name, but at that particular point, do I want to go, hey, I want to be in debt for $2 million? No, but at that point, God helps you step out in faith. You may have situations and callings of God where God is working in your life. He's trying to get you to the next step, and he will give you that extra faith to take that step, right? You know what God loves? He loves it when we do this, faith. A lot of times we're living in fear. No, it's got to be somebody else. I'm not sure about that. But God will help you. Even someone who may have the gift of faith that can come alongside you and encourage you. Listen, I know what God can do. I know how he can handle this. I know how he can provide for you. And so they can come along. What if you have that gift of faith and someone's struggling with it, what's your gift for? To help each other, right? And so you come along, you put your arm around them and say, look, I know in whom I believe, and I'm helping this, so let's take a step together. Here we go. We got it. Now let's watch God move. Do you see how it works? We are here helping each other, but it's all the Holy Spirit doing it. Then you have the gift of healing. Healing the sick either by laying on of hands, anointing with oil, that's according to James 5, or a bare word, it is the Holy Spirit who heals. Does that make sense? Many people, they're afraid. If somebody comes along and they say, hey, man, I need you to really pray for me. Okay, I'll pray for you. Well, then we don't pray. You know what I'm saying? Because we're afraid, I'm going to be real practical. A lot of times we're afraid to pray for someone because we don't know what's going to happen. And then we're worried. Right? Oh, that's going to make me look bad. No, it's not about you. Right? So if you're in this building right now or you're watching online, you may have the gift of healing. The problem is you never exercise it. You may have somebody here in this room, let me just be very practical here. Somebody here may have the gift of healing, right? But you don't know it because the enemy has you bound because you don't want to take a step of faith and believe in that God has called me to do that. And so what it is, it's still in seed form. It's buried, right? It's ready to grow. It's ready to sprout, and it's all the Holy Spirit. But he says to some, and this is what I believe. I believe that God will give to everyone, to a church, every one of these gifts to someone. All right? I don't say you have all the gifts. I'm not saying that. I'm saying there may be the gift of healing. There may be the gift of faith. There may be the gift of wisdom. There may be knowledge. But I believe in the church body itself, all those gifts should be active. All right? I believe that. I don't. Why would he plant a church and say, okay, I'm going to only give you three of those gifts, you know, but hey, miracles or healing or knowledge, no, that's for another church down the road. I don't think he's going to do that, right? So this is where, if you're watching today, and this is where we are, I'm trying to make it very, very practical. If you're praying, we can ask Holy Spirit, what is my gift? What is it? If it's one of these right here, you're the one that's deciding. What did you decide for me? Let that be your prayer. God, I want to know it because I want to help people in the church, right? If you got the gift of healing, we want to know it. Why? Because we're going to ask that you would be up here and you'd be praying if that's a gift. It's not to edify you. It's the Holy Spirit living in you. Are we on the same page? All right. So I'm telling you, somebody here may have the gift of faith. You may have the gift of healing. You may have the gift of knowledge, wisdom, whatever it is. But don't say, I don't have a gift, so I'm not going to do anything. Because according to this, every one of you, if you're saved, you got a gift. Amen? Amen. Amen. Just look at your neighbor and say, you got a gift. You got it. You got one. Here we go. So healing, we want to pray for that. Listen, when Jesus sent them out, he sent them out two by two. What did he do? He sent them out. What did they cast out devils and they healed the sick. I mean, they just did it. Why? Because it was the power of the Holy Spirit. Moving on, miracles. This is another one, right? This is the power. This is emerginata dynamion. It's such as raising the dead, restoring the blind to sight, giving speech to the dumb, hearing of the deaf, and the use of limbs to the lame. These are all miracles. Why? Jesus did every one of these. Okay? Now he comes along and he says, by the Holy Spirit will use them, and maybe you may have the gift of miracles. Right? We talked about, you know, the woman in Panama. I'm not necessarily saying I've got a gift of miracles. I'm not saying that. I believe at a time when we needed a miracle, that God performed a miracle. Does that make sense? You know, listen, a gift is not to exalt you. A gift is to exalt Jesus, okay? And so we don't go around walking around going, hey, I don't know about the kind of gift you got, but I got the gift of miracles. You know, I'm going to put a billboard up and, have me a bus because I got the gift of miracles. We don't do that. Why? Because we just talked about how should we walk. We walk in humility, right? And when the time is right, in an occasion, there may be an occasion for a miracle to happen, right? And the one with the gift of miracles can pray, and the Spirit will do it, all right? Some of you're going to get it. Because you're going to remove the fear, and you're going to get this. This is where I am right now. I just say, look, God, I can't do anything, but you can do everything, right? And anytime that I'm praying for somebody, right, I am praying and God believing that God's completely healing them in the name of Jesus. Amen? Completely healing them. I'm asking because it's Him doing it, all right? So don't be afraid to ask, right? Don't be afraid to believe. Then we come to discernment, the power to distinguish between true and false prophets, or to discern the real and internal qualifications of a person for an office, or to discover the inward workings of the mind by the Holy Spirit. Discernment is interesting. When we see the church had just started, day of Pentecost happened, we see all these salvations. Well, from that point, they started, people would come together, they would sell things, and they would bring all their money together, right? Well, there was a guy named Ananias, him and his wife Sapphira. You remember this story? But they came along, but they had already said, look, we sold this property, and we, this is how much we sold it, but we're going to tell them we only sold it for this much, so here's the money, right? Because Sapphira needed new shoes, you know what I'm saying? She needed a dress, and so she wasn't there at the time. She took her money and went shopping. That's just my interpretation. I don't believe it. Anyway, but she wasn't there. So he comes along and he says, hey, listen, Peter, just want you to know, we sold this property and this is all it is, and we're giving it all, so we can help the ministry of the church. You know what he said? Peter, with discernment, he looked at him and says, Holy Spirit speaking, why have you chose to lie to the Holy Spirit? Hey, this is the first church. This isn't Old Testament stuff. This is the first church. Why did you choose to lie to the Holy Spirit? And you know what he said? You see these guys right here? They're getting ready to drag your body out, right? Because you lied to the Holy Spirit, and he fell over dead. You think that was a serious, serious business, right? Boom. That's serious. He discerned he's lying. That should be a wake-up call to us. Let's don't play church, right? Let's get serious. The power of God is here. The power of God wants to work. But we got to make sure we are right with the Holy Spirit. Amen? And so they took him out and they buried him. Well, then along came Sapphira in her new dress and shoes. No, I'm kidding. Anyway, so she comes up and she said, hey, we gave that offering. Really? Yeah. All right. You mean this amount of much? That's what you sold the land for? Oh, yeah, this amount of much. That's what we did. Why have you and your husband decided to lie to the Holy Spirit? You know the story. He said, see those guys coming in? They just buried your husband. They're getting ready to bury you. Boom, she fell over dead. Is that serious business? Right? He had a spirit of discernment. You know what it did? It brought respect into the church. We're not playing church. We're not lying. We're not just doing what we want anytime we want. It's all fun again. No. All of a sudden it brought a seriousness that the power of God, he's holy and he's here and he's serious and he's planning a church because people are dying and they're going to hell and we need to be serious about it, right? And so it's not like I got a little toy. If I want to use it, I can. If I won't, no, not happening like that. Are y'all there? Here we go. 1 Corinthians. Then we see the one about the unknown languages or tongues. The ability to speak languages by inspiration or a message by the Holy Spirit edifying the church. In 1 Corinthians 14, it goes into deeper detail on this. It says if someone has a gift of tongues, we'll just start with that. If you have a gift of tongues and someone stands up and they give a message, this is the message. And then there's one that follows the interpretation of it. That is for the edification of the church. What Paul said, he said, let there be one or two, but no more than three. Why? Because they were out of order. Somebody would jump up and he'd be doing saying something over here in tongues, and this one over here would say something in tongues, and then they were, you know, and he even mentioned there, he said, man, people are going to think you're mad. There's no interpretation. There's supposed to be an interpretation for the edification of the church. And so when you look in 1 Corinthians 14, 4 and 5, it says, a person who speaks in tongues is strengthened personally, but one who speaks a word of prophecy strengthens the entire church. I wish you could all speak in tongues, but even more, I wish you could all prophesy. All right? And I missed the prophecy. A prophecy is the ability to tell future events. That's what they did in the past. They had the prophets would tell future events. But then it comes down a sense of prophecy or a forthtelling. We have the Word of God. We've read Revelation. We know what's coming. Does that make sense? We know what's coming. We know that there's the tribulation is coming. We can tell them what the future events are based upon the Word of God. Right? But also the foretelling of telling the good news of Jesus that he is coming, that we need to be prepared. And so what he was saying is, I would rather you speak 5 words in a known tongue than 10,000 words in an unknown tongue. Right? But he did not dismiss the fact that the tongues strengthened you personally. If you look at Romans 8, it talks about that. Times that we don't know how that we're going to be, how to pray about certain things, and the Holy Spirit will pray through you. He prays through you. So this is why he says, a person who speaks in tongues is strengthened personally, but the one who speaks word of prophecy strengthens the entire church. I wish you could all speak in tongues. Even more, I wish you could all prophesy. For prophecy is a greater than speaking in tongues unless someone interprets what you're saying so that the whole church will be strengthened. Does that make sense? All right, some of it, you're coming in like from maybe a Catholic background, Baptist background, a lot of things like this. A lot of times that spiritual gifts aren't mentioned because it's almost to the point we don't talk about spiritual gifts because we don't want things to get out of control. But as a result, sometimes we quench what the Holy Spirit wants to do, right? Does that make sense? So this is why we're working on this. So there is a fivefold ministry of the church. In Ephesians 4:11, it says, now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. So the question is, now that you have a gift, do something with it. Do something with it. All right? Eunice, would you come up here just for a moment? Ladies and gentlemen, Eunice. All right, look, this is your spiritual gift, right? Now, you can keep it, or you can do something with it to edify, all right? That's totally your choice, all right? A lot of people, they just want to keep it and hang on to it, and they never bless anybody else. But I'm going to give you this gift. What do you choose to do with it? You're going to give it away? You want to go ahead and just give it? Go ahead. You're going to give it away. All right, so what does she do? She has a gift. All right, simple illustration, but what does she do? She's blessing other people with a gift. Does that make sense? Are you blessed? All right. Stephanie, you glad he finally got a mint? Yes. All right, no. Come here. All right. Hey, but you know what God does? When you are giving your gift away, he continues to give you the gift, right? And because you have given a gift away, you were using it, well, guess what? You get the rest of the bag, all right? Because he wants to bless you for doing it, all right? Does that make sense? All right. Listen, it's a simple illustration, but you know what? If she was standing up here and she kept it off, she goes, no, I need it, I want it, and I'm going to keep it all to myself. You know what she's representing? Probably about 90% of the church. That's what's happening in churches today. The church is filled with people who say, I am born again. I love Jesus. I have a relationship with him. I do my devotions in the morning, and I read, and I do all of that. And he says, that's great, because you're my child, and because you're my child, I give you a gift. Thank you. I'm going to keep it to myself. I don't want anybody else knowing. You know what? Can I say this? I mean, I just want to, this isn't guilt. I just want to just talk to you just for a second from my heart. I wonder how many times, how many people who have been in churches who've actually never got healed because the person with the gift of healing kept it to themselves. You see why it's important that every single one of us need to be asking the question, God, what is it that you've given me that you want to use through me? Okay? I don't care how long you've been saved. I don't care what your background has been. If you are born again, you have the Spirit living within you, you have a gift. And I'm telling you, what God is wanting to do in these last days, listen to me. What God is wanting to do in these last days, he wants the manifestations of his Spirit working, and that every one of the gifts that he has for the church should be very active in the church. And they will not be active until the people who have those gifts begin to be obedient. Amen. That is the message today. Amen. We'll finish the rest of it next week. I want us to bow our heads and close our eyes just for a moment. And I want you just to ask the Lord. I want you, one, ask, am I truly saved? Have I truly been born again? That's the question I want you to ask. If you've been saved, then understand this truth. You have the Holy Spirit within you, and you have a gift that God wants to use. Now, the question is, between you and the Lord, God, what is it? Holy Spirit, what is it? It says the Spirit gives to those as he decides. What is your gift? And I believe that what Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice and they follow me. And when he is speaking to you, you may have the gift of teaching. You may have a gift of preaching. You may have the gift of wisdom or knowledge or prophecy or miracles or healing. I don't know what your gift is, but he does. And it may be just in seed form, but he's saying it's time to let this thing grow. People need help. And time is running out. And it's time for me to work through you in a power that you've never experienced. And if you're willing, I really believe he will speak to you, he will show you, and he will give you opportunity to use that gift. So from your heart to his, as we're before the Lord, Father, we come in the name of Jesus, and we're asking, as we read your word and you study, we study this, we see it, it's clear. The Holy Spirit has given us gifts as he decides to do. And then we're asking that, help us know what it is. Help us to step in faith and to say, yes, Lord, here am I. Use me. Use this gift inside of me. Give me the opportunities. Show me. Speak through me. Pray through me. Heal through me. Whatever it is. But I want that whatever you created me for and whatever the gift is, that it would be used in these last days like it's never been before. And that you would receive all the glory because it's you doing it. And Father, I pray, open the ears of your children. Open the eyes that they can see you. Lord, let us hear you. And Father, by faith, I believe Fellowship of the Nations will be a church operating in the power of the Holy Spirit, and that all the gifting would be used for your glory. And Father, I thank you. I want to thank you in advance for the souls that are going to be saved, the sick that are going to be healed, the marriages that are going to be healed, the lives are going to be transformed. Father, we know it's all about winning souls and making disciples. So, Father, we ask that you would do it. We thank you for doing it in the name of Jesus. With heads bowed and eyes closed, I just want to say this. If you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, today you can. You can. When we stand up, I'm just going to ask that you would walk forward. If that's what you want to do, you know that you're lost. And say, Johnny, I need Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I don't have a gift because I don't have the Holy Spirit living within me. If that's you, get it settled today. And when we stand, just come walk forward and we'll talk to you here on the side. So, Father, be glorified. Holy Spirit, do what you desire to do right now. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's all stand for this last song. If you have,
I want to thank you so much for being a part of our online streaming. I hope you really enjoyed the message today. And I want you to just take it to heart. Whatever the Lord has spoken to you, just take it to heart. And I pray that if you have never received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that today would be that day. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. So that's what we're praying for you. And if you're wondering, how do I get to know Jesus as my Lord and Savior? Well, let me tell you, it's pretty simple. First of all, Jesus loves you more than anybody on this planet. So let me tell you, He's wanting you to know Him. So as you come to Him, we recognize, one, that we've sinned against God. Everybody has. The Bible says that all have sinned. We've fallen short of the glory of God. Well, we recognize that one. We don't have to be told that. We know that. The second thing is, it says that God demonstrated His love for us, and that's you. God loves you even though that we were sinners. That's how much He cares for you. So you got to get it out of the way. He's not judging you. He already sent His Son to die in our place so that we could have all of our sin placed upon Him. And then we believe, we had faith in Him, that that's what He did. And He did it because He loved us. The Bible says the wages of our sin is death. Well, Jesus took our death sentence for us. But then it doesn't leave it as a negative. It says, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus. It's not works. It's not a church membership somewhere. It's not giving money to somebody. All of those are good things, but this does not bring salvation. So now, how do you get there? It's only in Jesus. So simply just open your heart and say, Jesus, I'm a sinner. Please forgive me of my sin. Come into my heart. Save me. Forgive me. I want to turn away from all the stupid stuff that I'm doing. And I want to turn to you. I want you to be my Lord, my Savior, the boss of my life. And Jesus, come in and save me. I want to love you. I want to live for you. I want to obey your word all the days of my life. And that's what you can do. Pray that prayer right now. And I'll tell you, Jesus is waiting. And the moment, the instant you do that, you will be saved. And my encouragement to you, find a great Bible-believing, Bible-preaching church. Get connected. Now, if you're in the Houston area, man, we would love to have you at Fellowship of the Nations. But you're in different parts of the country or even around the world, find somewhere that they're preaching Jesus. And I promise you, it will change your life. Hope you can join us again next week. And up until then, we'll be praying for you. Pray for us. We'd love to hear from you. Just go on our website, FOTN.org, Fellowship of the Nations, and let us hear from you. God bless you.